Hi, and welcome to my talk, Service-Based License Verification of Open Source Software. This is work primarily done by Stephen Romansky, my master's student, with Blackduck under an NSERC engage, and I'm Abram Hindle. We're from the University of Alberta. So, what we're going to do is we're going to introduce our problem, give you some background on licenses and code clones, talk about finding licenses and clones and using web service, evaluation, then what's next. So, developers share and publish their code on the web. People who share their code expect it to be reused. So not only do they share their code, people download code off the web and use them in their products, especially open source products. And the developers who share their code typically use licenses to control the reuse of this code. So one question is, when reusing source code, do developers obey the licenses of the code they take? So, one of the big sources of code that people take would be Stack Overflow. For instance, there's this humorous fake O'Reilly book, copy and pasting from Stack Overflow, by the practical developer. And essentially, there is a worry that people are just taking code willy-nilly and not actually obeying what's going on. So, this is possibly exacerbating given the fact that there was estimated about 20 million developers in 2013, and developers now rely on GitHub Stack Overflow like services during development. GitHub has about 20 million users as of 2017, and typically host code that is to be shared, and this code is typically licensed. We don't really know what's actually going on. We don't know how much is appearing in Stack Overflow, how much is being taken to other stuff. So one of our goals is to essentially produce a web service whereby you paste in code and it queries Stack Overflow and says, oh, there was this similar code on Stack Overflow. And the code should not necessarily be exact. It should be maybe a small snippet. So what we're really going to try to do in order for that to work is that we have to actually detect copy and paste. Furthermore, we want to infer the licenses of copy and paste. And can we detect the relicensing of copy and paste? Are the licenses maintained? Furthermore, can we detect invalid relicensing of copy and paste? For instance, Stack Overflow is CC by SA, which is not a good software license. It wasn't meant for software. It's not GPL compatible, and it's quite awkward, and doesn't even enforce open sourceness. It can be binaryized and reshared. It's really strange. Unfortunately, none of this stuff will deal with the fact that you still have to attribute the source code. So what we're going to do is we're going to detect code clones, and then we're going to infer their licenses. Code clones are basically two segments of source code that appear similar to one another under like some kind of similarity function, like Euclidean distance or Levenshtein distance, anything like that, any similar. It could just be bitwise distance. The web service will basically load a data set of license code samples, and the user will send code to it, and they'll ask, is my code similar? Does the code clones that I do have, are they compatible? So impact is we want to help developers make compliant code for various reasons. We want to help and promote. We want to promote and help and integrate Blackduck services at the copy and paste level. And we want to understand how developers use licenses and how their licenses impact reuse. So we're going to go into some background here. So first off, we're going to talk about code clones. You can think of these as copy and paste and copy and paste and adapt. So like I said before, code clones are two bits of code that appear to be similar to each other under some idea of similarity. Furthermore, code clones can come in multiple granularities. They can be small or big, a couple of lines, entire classes. And what we do is we basically look at the method, class, and module level in this presentation. So Janney et al. Describes several code clone types, ranging from a type 1 that's identical to a type 3 which is adapted. So if we look at the code clone granularity, we could be at the token level, we could be at the line level, we could be at the block level, we could be groups of lines, but we're going to focus on semantic levels like functions and methods, classes, modules, and packages. So here's some example Python code. It's got one big function and one big class. The module would be the entire file. The class would be the test class at the bottom itself, highlighted in white. And functions would be all the different functions. So we've got basically 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 functions in there. So we've got a bunch of functions highlighted. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 functions highlighted. And yeah. So we're going to do multiple, we're going to duplicate our blocks. So what's going to happen is you really want the block matching the level of granularity. So if we're asking at a module level, we're asking for the whole module if it's being cloned. At the function level, we're asking if the whole function is being cloned. At the class level, we're asking if the whole class is being cloned. And we need to be able to handle all these granularities. So here's an example of a type 1 clone. These are code clones that have identical code segments. So all the identifiers are the same, all literals are the same. Type 2 is a type 1 with differing names and literal values. So in this case, we've got state and time. They got different identifier names, but they effectively do the same thing. There's just tokens, like literals, that are replaced. A type 3 is an augmented or adapted one, whereby extra information is added, different comments, different features, different lines, and you can have the modification internally. So if you were going at line blocks, you'd miss out. So we got license. So that was the code clones, and that's what we're going to be looking into. But we also care about the licenses. So what are software licenses? Effectively, they're a way to deal with copyright. So copyright basically gives exclusive control to the owner, and the owner has to allow others to use their source code or their writing in some form or fashion. Typically, copyright limits use and distribution, so most software licenses address use and redistribution and derivative works. So software licenses, typically what they do is they can give limitations, like you can only distribute this to 5 different computers. And then if you had another software license which says that everyone must be able to copy and redistribute this software down the line, that would violate the other one. So Apple App Store has a limitation on the number of devices that something can be installed on. And the GPL says someone should be able to install this as many times and on many things as they want. So they're not really compatible. So open source licenses are basically licenses meant for allowing software to be reused in a way that includes attribution and allows for sharing. And open source licenses are not free from conflicts. They're not all compatible with each other. For instance, these licenses on the left, Zlib, Xpat, X11, they're all compatible with weak copyleft licenses like LGPL. And they can be converted to LGPL3, and then that means that you're compatible with GPL3. Apache 2, on the other hand, is not compatible with LGPL 2.1 or GPL2, and thus it's only compatible with LGPL3 or GPL3. So that would be considered a violation. Now, based on if the license is permissive or copyleft or not, it limits what can be done downstream. So if you got an upstream permissive license, you can convert it to permissive, copyleft, or proprietary. If you got an upstream copyleft, a copyleft license can take permissive as upstream and can only really produce copyleft, whereas a permissive license can only really be used in proprietary software. A copyleft license could not be used in proprietary software very easily. So we got this idea of licensing compatibility. So essentially, if you saw an Apache 2 license and then you saw a GPL 2 license or an LGPL license or even an Apache 2 license and X11 license, you might not be able to deal with compatibility issues. So what we're going to do is now we're going to talk about the tool itself. We're going to present empirical results of the tool. We're going to show screenshots. So this series of screenshots basically is showing us looking at the main user interface, uploading our source files, clicking update query set to generate a report, getting our report name, retrieving our report, and finally viewing our report, which is essentially a data set and query set, and it shows us how big the clones are that it's found. So if we go and look at these clones, essentially they look a lot like this. So this is within the same file. So this is internal because we got the same file in the query set. What are the code clones? And this is a copy and paste clone inside the same file, which is really strange because they could have just made a function. But it's copy and pasted, and they've only changed one thing, the job kill and the process kill. That's it. It's just one little thing, and it's just changing JSON. Whereas this is a neat example whereby we look at generated code from distutils in Python. It's essentially the setup tools. They make this setup method, and this method has a bunch of metadata, but that structure is similar. So the code cloner actually comes up with this, which is really neat because it means that you can be quite flexible in what the code clone looks like. We can also pick up numerous small clones like getters and setters. And here's an example of potential license conflict, but it's not really because too many of the tokens have changed. And it kind of shows you the danger of having a small number of tokens. So you really want to maybe threshold your tokens a little bit higher. So what do we do? We've got a system whereby you give a query set to a client manager, and then it calls on its client clone detectors, who then generate a report. So essentially you submit your query, the manager sends it to the clients, clients run clone detection on different parts of the corpus, reports are generated, and the user can see the clones in the report. In order to do this, we need to identify licenses, and we use the Ninka tool. In order to detect clones, we use the Sorcerer CC tool. For infrastructure, we stitch these all together as a web service. So for licenses, we use Ninka. It can identify 112 licenses, and it was basically handcrafted by researchers. To build it, researchers investigated 30,000 files, and they looked at the license specification format, basically where the license is, what are its terms. They looked at common developer modifications like grammar, spelling errors, modifications, and adding names like that. So essentially what they do is they take your source code and they try to extract the license comment found near the beginning. They identify potential license lines using keywords that they've extracted from licenses. And this is kind of non-trivial because not all licenses are done the same way. So here's a Python program and their license is a string literal. It's an unassigned string literal. It could have been a comment, but it's not. So it's a string in the program. And it's also decorated with ASCII art, which means that you can't necessarily do easy comparison on that. Then, once they've identified the license lines, they replace equivalent phrases such that they can have rules that they can use to basically identify these 12 equivalence rules and break it down into which licenses they are. Because sometimes the difference between like BSD 1 and 2 aren't always clear until you look at the one at how heavy their attribution clause is, the advertising clause. So I do that, and they basically have 127 rules, and it can identify 112 licenses. Unfortunately, this is at the file level, so we still have stuff to improve if the license information is external to the actual file being analyzed. And then for code clones, what we do is we need the code block extraction. So we use Sorcerer CC for code clone detection. And what Sorcerer CC does is it converts code blocks to bags of tokens. It indexes these bags of tokens, and it can search the index for similar bags, and it can apply similarity thresholds to prune unsuccessful candidates. So first off, we get the source code, we extract the blocks, and we extract the blocks at multiple levels. Function level, class level, and module level. This means that we'll have big code bags and small code bags. A module will not necessarily match a function based on that thresholding. So essentially we take some code and then we bag it, which basically means we count the terms in the code. So if we had we had a Python exception called timeout, so we make a class called timeout, and it's an exception, and we provide an empty body, so we use pass, it would turn into that. Then, once we've got the code blocks, we have to compare the code blocks. And instead of taking every code block and doing pairwise comparison, which is about n squared, what we do is what Sorcerer C does is they make an inverted index. For every token in the code block, they keep track of code blocks with that token. Okay? So basically, you build a map from tokens to bags, and then given a token, you find almost all the bags, you can find all the bags quicker than naive comparison. And then what you can do is if you retrieve the bags, you can actually filter out bags that don't match enough. So if they don't have the number of tokens to meet a similarity threshold, you remove them. And so basically you have like these stats about the intersection between your query code bags and your requested code bags, and so you can filter them out. The second one is basically sort the bags based on token frequency from surveying all bags. The most common tokens will be compared first, and then this means you can quickly reject a mismatch. And you can also just only compare up to a given threshold, like 80%. So the general gist is we have a set of code clones, we get a code bag from code, and then for each token in that code bag, we query the inverted index for that token. We get those code bags, and those code bags typically contain all the bags. Those code bags will be all the bags containing that token, and then we filter those code bags using our speedups. And then once we've got the similarity comparison, the similarity buckets, we can append them to our code clones. So we filter, and then map, and then append. So we don't need to match the whole bag. Another threshold is basically we only do 80% of tokens per bag match, and the result would be a set of clone ID pairs. Now in order for this to work, we actually had to modify Sorcerer CC a lot because it was meant to start up and quit. So off the shelf, Sorcerer CC basically loads the query and the corpus, it runs clone detection and quits. So we had to modify Sorcerer CC to load the corpus and receive queries against the corpus. Once loaded, though, and daemonized, numerous queries can be made. So this allows you to basically put a data set into the client, and then the client listens and waits for queries. So essentially, basically, all this stitched together allows the user to submit a query to the manager. The manager sends stuff off to clone detectors. Clone detectors run Ninka and Sorcerer CC. They produce reports on each of their corpuses. The client manager aggregates the corpus. So essentially, code is parsed and prepared for clone detection. Code licenses detect with Ninka. The data set is loaded on the clients. The query code is sent to the clients and evaluated with Sorcerer CC. The clone license report is generated. Reports are aggregated by the manager. So we stitch this all together using RESTful technology. Our manager's job is basically to accept and send queries to clients and show code clone reports. The client loads datasets, it listens for queries, and it evaluates queries against the dataset and generates reports. So essentially, the job of the manager is to register clients, it's to show specific results, allow the posting of results, as well as allow the user to upload and upload data. And then the clients, they basically can be turned off, that you can make a query against them, they can register with the manager, and they can also indicate their status. So now we've got this system that does code clones. How well does it actually work? So what we do is we extract Python projects from pip and the Python package manager, and that's our data set. So we've got basically a bunch of test set partitions. We got a 10 project set, 100 project set, 1,000 project set, and a 50,000 project set, or 5,000 project set, sorry. And sometimes there's projects that aren't perfect, so we remove them, but they're pretty close for the most part. So they range from a megabyte of code to 2 gigabytes of code. So we got our test partitions, and the machine we run on is pretty good. 64 gigs of RAM, 8 cores, big SSDs. And what happens is we can see that if you've got not a lot of projects and a small corpus, you've got basically very fast responses. Even if you fill it all up with 1,000 to 500, 5,000 stuff to query, you've got sub-second responses. When you move to a corpus of 100, you've got about 1 second responses, and then the corpus of 1,000, typically its results are a little bit worse. It's got about 5 to 7 seconds, and then there's this extreme performance regression, which we're addressing at the moment. So what's neat though is because we got the multi-client thing, the performance that we care about is basically this performance here in the 100 zone. So we could run many clients that only had 100 projects. So given a corpus of 1,000, you run 10 clients. Given a corpus of 50,000 or 5,000, you can run 50 clients. So we got some performance issues that we have to address. So performances depend on query size. We have to tune the client corpuses, but we can exploit the independence of projects in the query set versus corpus. And the licensing inference is incomplete. It doesn't have knowledge of Python pip setup.py or any Blackduck integration. Furthermore, the reports can be improved by filtering and UI things. So what's next? Well, we want to get a bunch of GitHub data through ghTorrent such that we can have a large corpus of GitHub code to compare against. We want Stack Overflow data. We want all the code snippets from Stack Overflow. We want to improve the parsers. We want to query GitHub data. We really, really want to integrate GitHub tools and data sources into license inference, as well as leverage GitHub data sets, like stuff that's on the hub. In conclusion, by using off-the-shelf components, we've achieved good performance in only 4 months. We've developed a working code clone query system that can detect copy and paste programming of different clone types and estimate a license for each snippet. And it has sub-7-second performance on a project versus a corpus of 1,000 existing projects. All the clones are found, so that's pretty useful. Conflicts can be highlighted. So it's primarily work done by Steven Romansky, and I'm a supervisor at Mahindra.